Hello and a very warm welcome to the CNBC TV 18 special. I am Priya Sheth and I'm in conversation with Hindustan Unilever top boss Sanjiv Mehta. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Pleasure, real pleasure.
This is the fifth consecutive quarter of double-digit volume growth. What's really driven volumes for HUL, and if you can run us through how sustainable is this kind of volume growth?
You know, when you talk about sustainability, then I think I would rather portray a bit longer picture. If you look at the last 6 years of HUL's performance, we've added a delta turnover of nearly 12,400 crores. Now, 12,400 crores implies that the delta turnover would be the largest FMCG business in the country. Yeah? And during the same period, our EBITDA has more than doubled. And during the same period, while the BSE or the Nifty index or the FMCG index has gone up by 1.8 to 2, we have been re-rated because of our performance, and the HUL market cap has gone up by 3.5x. So I would say that look at our 6 years performance and then you will get a picture on how our focus on the long term has helped the business. Last five quarters have indeed been pleasing. We have had double-digit volume growth on our size and scale. Delivering double-digit volume growth is always pleasing. But you have to remember that as the biggest FMCG company, we are part of the Indian macro ecosystem. And while FMCG per se is an industry which is more resilient, still it is definitely dependent on what happens around you, yeah, from an economic perspective, from an inclusive growth perspective, and we always say that for what is important for FMCG is not just the absolute GDP growth, but the inclusive growth.
You know, over the last couple of years, the FMCG industry has been through a tough time with demonetization, with the teething troubles as far as GST is concerned. But from your perspective, do you think that the worst is over for the FMCG space structurally? And do you think that volumes could grow in perhaps mid-teens or, around that band if going forward?
In India still, 2/3 of the population is rural India. And that is the reason we always focus on rural India. We monitor the rural consumption very closely to get a sense of what is happening over there for the simple reason that the per capita consumption in rural is half the national average. So there have been challenges, not just the regulatory challenges. Also, if you look at those 2 years, 14-15, 15-16, 16-17, you had two consecutive years of drought. Yeah, so it went through a turbulent period, but yes, demonetization is behind us, GST is behind us from a perspective of the transition.
So you're saying that the worst is perhaps over for the FMCG?
From a regulatory changes, the disruptions which happened with the regulatory changes, those are behind us.
I wanted to understand with regards to the overall scenario of demand. You said that in your earnings press meet, you said that demand has been stable, near-term demand. But going forward, you said that you're going to be watchful of the macroeconomic situation. So run us through what are the key risks or the challenges that you perceive going ahead?
You know, for FMCG, there are two things. One are the macroeconomic factors. The second is what we call as the consumer confidence, yeah, the feel-good factor. Now, let me first talk about consumer confidence. What helps consumer confidence? First is a stable government. Yeah. The second important bit is when there is optimism about the future. When people feel the wage rates will go up, when people feel that for children there will be better employment opportunities, that is where the consumer confidence goes up. Yeah. The second is the macroeconomic. While we are resilient, it does play a big part. Now, if we have to really harness the potential that exists in India, then we will have to cross the chasm of growth, which is the band of 6.5 to 7.5, which has been the kind of story for the last few years, and move into 8-9, if not the double-digit growth.
But when you look at two big events that are coming up, we have the budget and we have the elections. A lot of rural SOPs, SOPs for farmers, SOPs for rural allocation, high rural allocation is expected going forward. How will HUL benefit from that?
You know, I am of the firm belief that the next government will have to put a lot of focus on agriculture reforms to really harness the latent potential of the economy in the country.
So rural has been growing 1.3 times that of urban for HUL.
It should be growing at a much faster pace. Yeah, look at it, that you're talking about a per capita consumption half that of the national average.
So over the next two quarters, can we expect rural to grow 2x as that of urban, back to historical levels with the kind of boost that's on its way for the rural areas?
See, first is we never give guidance. I wouldn't like to predict the demand. And a lot depends on how much money, in what shape and form, and whom does it reach to. Yeah. When you look at, for instance, a waiver of farm loans, then it normally goes to the landowners. Yeah. We also have to ensure that the farm wages goes up. That is when you put more money in the hands of a large number of people. So one has to see in what shape and form the benefits go down to the rural areas before we can envisage. And then also there is a lag period. It's not that it's not like putting on and putting off the button. It's not like, you do it today and it happens tomorrow.
Let's talk about the other key risk that a lot of companies face, which is input costs. And we've seen softening input costs over the last quarter, at least sequentially, if you were to say so. Going forward, what is your outlook on how input costs will move?
You know, no one can today predict the oil prices. And in the last 6 years, we have seen massive volatility of commodity price, be it in vegetable oils or be it in crude oil. And for us as a business, crude oil, currency, vegetable oil, all this plays a big part. So one is not much worried about how the commodity prices are going to move, because no point in worrying about something which you can't control. I think what we have done as a business is enhanced the agility in the business so that we can respond with speed to whatever the situation might happen. We keep a laser-like focus on strategic pricing and also, very importantly, on the price-value equation.
When you talk about pricing, 2-3% has been the kind of price growth that we've seen over the last quarter. Is there scope for further hike in prices? Are there categories that you would like to call out which could perhaps be categories where you could drive growth through price?
Yeah, let me give you a philosophy of a pricing. First is there is no one-to-one correspondence between input price and the final price of a finished product. We look at all lines of the P&L, and when the prices go up, we try to optimize other lines of the P&L. And we always are circumspect about pricing. We take judicious price increase. We try to protect the price point packs, and then we play the portfolio game. You will see we have number one category positions in nearly 85% of our portfolio. And in this portfolio, invariably you will find we straddle the price benefit pyramid. If you look at our history, in the last 29 out of 30 quarters, we have improved our EBITDA margin. The only quarter where we did not was the demonetization quarter, and there too, because we did not shy away from investing behind the brands for the long term.
Premiumization has been a cornerstone of your strategy, but I wanted to understand, you've done some realignment in your home care portfolio as well. You've brought in more focus on the premium devices in the purifier space. But in your overall portfolio, would you like the portfolio to be a 50-50 premium versus non-premium?
Let me give you a bit more insight into the market. Yeah, if we break up the market, then you're talking about that market lens, that premium end, which is 120 index to the average of the market, is about 28%. Yeah. And then you're talking about the balance 72% spread between the mid-tier, which is the biggest part of the business, and then you have the mass, which is about close to 30-32% of the business. Yeah. Now, in that scenario, if you index our shares, then at the mass end, if you take my market share as 1, then at the mid-tier, my market shares are 1.2x, and at the premium end, my market shares are 1.3x. So if the market premiumizes, which we facilitate to a large extent, it is to my benefit because I have larger share in the premium end. So as the country progresses, you will find one is the average point also changing because the mix changes between mid-tier and price and the premium end. And of course, everyone clamoring for a product which orders, which provides bigger benefits.
With that, let's slip into a very short break. There's lots more on the other side.